David, we're just coming off of this news by the Federal Reserve and the Bank of Canada to hold steady with respect to interest rates for now. The futures market pricing in at least 6 rate hikes over the course of 2022, courtesy of the Federal Reserve. How has this news to hold affected expectations?
Well, I think that, the fact that the Fed and the Bank of Canada didn't do anything, it's really, you know, what they said. And their tone was, I think, more hawkish than market participants were expecting. Of course, there were some people that thought the bank might start raising rates immediately. And it seems to me, based on the verbiage, that the central banks are really on autopilot. And it's really quite striking, especially in the U.S., because we know that the first quarter GDP is going to be flat to negative. I don't remember a time in my 35 years in the business when the Fed started a tightening cycle with the economy flat in its back. Of course, the Fed will come back and say, well, it's Omicron and it'll be temporary. And their forecast is for a vigorous snapback for the balance of the year. But that's, you know, look, when we talk about the stock markets, there's always a myriad of factors that underpin the direction and the veracity. And there's the technical picture, there's the fundamentals, there's valuation, there's market positioning, but there's also liquidity. And we have to keep in mind that, you know, the market surged off the March 2020 lows, really less on fundamentals. I mean, earnings did a round trip, but 70% of the bull market off the March 2020 lows and the S&P 500, 70% was pure price earnings multiple expansion. Only 30% was actually earnings growth. And in a normal healthy market, those numbers are reversed. Normally, it's 70% earnings, 30% multiple. And that multiple came via the Fed's dramatic liquidity infusions. And now that's going in the rearview mirror. And that's what the markets are adjusting to, really, is a whole new environment now as it pertains to Fed policy.
Do you think that ultimately the mandate has changed? And now the story has shifted to inflation dominating all, it seems. Has that mandate changed?
Well, the mandate hasn't really changed. What's changed is the Fed's patience with this inflation backdrop. So look, nobody I know, even the most ardent inflation hawks, thought we'd be at 7% inflation right now. The Fed thought it was going to be transitory. It depends how you define transitory, but you can see that the Fed has been very surprised. Powell's commentary was really about how the production bottlenecks are going to be with us quite a bit longer. And their view is that demand, even if it slows, is going to remain above supply. So their big concern is that inflationary pressures are going to be with us for the balance of the year at a time when the unemployment rate is below 4%. So, you know, my perspective is that, you know, how can we make any assertion about anything in the context of a pandemic that isn't going away? But the Fed isn't taking any chances. Their big concern at this point is that this turns into a classic wage price spiral and that they really fall behind the inflation curve. So I think that's really what the mentality is right now. And at the same time, you know, the yield curve, both in Canada and the United States, are pretty flat. We've rarely ever gone to a tightening cycle with the yield curve as flat as it is. And so, you know, you brought up before that, you know, the market now is pricing in close to 6 rate hikes in the U.S., 5 rate hikes in Canada. And if we get that sort of increase in short-term interest rates and the bond market doesn't move that much, they're going to invert the yield curve and we're going to have a recession on our hands. So by sometime in the second half of this year, we're not going to be talking about inflation. We're going to be talking about a recession. And I think that those odds are rising. And that's one of the reasons why the stock market's been having a rough time over the course of the past month or so.
The credibility of central banks has come into question recently because of this decision to pause on interest rate hikes. Does this matter? Is this a thing?
Well, I don't think it is, but, you know, I almost feel sorry for Jay Powell because he's coming under attack in the media, in academia, and even on Wall Street. But yet when you go to actual market pricing, if we were to see, say, the markets saying that the Fed was really behind the curve, that this was really systemic inflation over and beyond just the effects of the global pandemic, then we'd be seeing the yield curve steepen. We'd be in a huge bear steepener, and bond yields would be ratcheting up much more dramatically than they have. And that hasn't happened. We'd be seeing, if there was a real loss of confidence in U.S. monetary policy, the U.S. dollar would be slip sliding away. But the dollar's at an 18-month high. You'd be seeing gold prices rally substantially. Gold has basically just been range trading. And you're taking a look at the five-year forwards in terms of inflation expectations beyond the near term, and they're at 2%. So there's nothing in the market variables telling me that the Fed is behind the curve, but the narrative has shifted dramatically. And let's face it, you know, when you have President Biden, actually, it's the first president I could ever remember pressuring the Fed to raise interest rates. Usually it's the opposite. Look what Powell faced with Donald Trump. Usually the presidents pressure the Fed to cut rates. But because Biden is feeling the heat because he's getting the blame on inflation, he's pressuring the Fed to raise rates. There's a lot of political pressure here for the Fed to at least show that they're doing something about inflation. What I'm saying is that be careful what you wish for, because 6 months from now, we'll be talking about a recession and inflation is going to be relegated to the back pages of the newspapers.
You had touched on gold. You had touched on the dollar. Tell us about this changing relationship between the dollar and oil, especially now, given this landscape of rising oil prices.
Well, you know, what's interesting is that oil, as you know, is priced in U.S. dollars. And usually oil does better, as most commodities do, when the dollar is under downward pressure. So you've got a rising dollar and you've got rising oil prices, which is telling you, really less about demand. We know that because of the Omicron and the impact that's had on travel, this is not a demand story. It really comes down to OPEC plus their stinginess and the chronic lack of supply. So you don't need a lot of demand to cause the oil price to go up, but it's not really a dollar story. There could be some geopolitical aspects to this too. I mean, oil is viewed as a geopolitical hedge. And, you know, with the situation with Russia and Ukraine, you know, that could be viewed as a fund flow impact that's supporting the price of oil. But it's not really a dollar story, or else oil would be going down. It's really fundamentally just a chronic story of a general lack of supply relative to demand in the oil market that continues to support the price action.
David, do you think of Bitcoin as an inflation hedge?
Well, not really. And we just don't have enough of a history. To me, it's just a it's a playground for speculators. If people believe that it's funny that, you know, it's a great question because everybody's got inflation on the brain. If you thought that Bitcoin was an inflation hedge, it's down 20% this year. I think I look at Bitcoin, you know, and I'm not talking about the blockchain technology. I'm not talking about the efficiencies and financial transactions that comes about from digital currencies. I always was very skeptical that you can take these and say, well, this, I'm going to form a currency into an asset class. That never made sense to me. The volatility in Bitcoin is surreal. And to me, it was just part and parcel of the speculation you had in the most volatile fringe parts of the stock market, the meme stocks, and the other forms of speculation that you saw in other parts of the financial market landscape that have all come down at the same time. The correlation actually was probably more with Cathie Wood's funds, in the sense that Bitcoin really ultimately resembled the peak of greed this cycle and the peak of speculative fervor. That's really what it was correlated with, and I don't think anything more fundamental than that.
As we get ready for this rate hike cycle, where do you see Canada's residential real estate market ending up?
Well, we did the work on this, and there's so much leverage and so much excess valuation in Canadian residential real estate. And of course, people can talk about, well, we have immigration and we have very low interest rates. We have a chronic lack of supply of zonable land, so on and so forth. We've had those issues for years. Even when you adjust for how low interest rates are, home prices in Canada are still 15 to 20% overvalued relative to their income fundamentals. This makes what happened in the late 1980s that John Crow had to tackle like a walk in the park. This is And if you look globally, Canada's got pretty well the most bubbly residential real estate market in the world. And it is the longest duration asset, it is the most credit sensitive asset. There is a tremendous amount of investment, speculation, and leverage in the Canadian housing market. There's no way this is all fundamental. So the bank's going to raise rates. We don't know how far. I'll just say this much. If the futures market is right and the Fed hikes rates five times, and you look specifically as well on the volume of short-term mortgages, variable rate mortgages, a lot of people are going to get hit by 100, 125 basis points. People don't think that that's a big deal because they say, oh, well, the level of interest rates will still be relatively low. No. It's not the level that matters. It's the change. I would say that this is probably going to have a very significant impact on the Canadian residential real estate market. I think the good news is that if you're sitting on the fence to buy a home, or you're a renter and you've longed to buy, get into the home ownership market, you're going to get that chance at much better price levels. If you're a homeowner right now and you bought in the past year or two, your big risk is you're going to have negative equity in your home. Hopefully you won't default. But my sense is that what the Bank of Canada is about to do, if the futures market is right, it's going to be extremely painful for the housing market. And I know people will always say, well, there's the boy who cried wolf, to which I say, well, just remember, the wolf shows up at the end of the story.
You have touched on elements right across the board. Give us an idea of investor portfolio composition in this landscape.
Well, I think that you want to be turning defensive right now. And it's very difficult for people to part with their stocks. And if you're in love with your stocks, I would still say, well, you don't have to sell them, but maybe you want to sell some call options against your portfolio and collect the premium. I think you want to find ways to de-risk. That would mean either selling calls, it would mean raising cash, moving to the areas of the market that are defensive, that will still hang in even if we get a deep economic slowdown or recession. That could mean utilities, it could mean pipelines, it could mean consumer staples. Those are the areas of the market I think that should do well. I think in this area of heightened geopolitical risks and military spending going up everywhere, including, you know, pacifist Japan, you want to be exposed to global defense stocks as well, insofar as that could fit into, say, non-ESG portfolios. I think that, I would be shifting out of stocks into bonds. I know that sounds crazy. People always say to me, why would you buy a long bond yield at, say, 2%? Well, you're not buying it for the yield. You're really buying it for the price. And the reality is that in every bear market, and the markets are telling you that we're going into a bear market, your total return damage is cut in half if you have exposure to bonds. So you're not buying bonds for yield. Understand, you're not buying bonds for yield. You're buying bonds for price, and you're buying bonds for diversification. And the fact that they're inversely correlated with the stock market. And that's really what you want to do right now. It's very important, I think, after these past couple of years of inordinate returns, abnormal returns, and now the liquidity is going to seep out of the market because of the central banks, understanding what that's going to mean for the market multiple, let alone what earnings are going to be doing. I would say that you want to be extremely defensive in your portfolio. And if you haven't de-risked already, it's not too late to do so.